Once more, hello everybody, and welcome back to my class, the Linux Fundamentals class, part two. So I hope all of you have either been present last Monday or you have seen the video that I recorded on YouTube. In case you have not received the link to the YouTube video, post a message in chat. That's probably the best way. I can still post a link to the recording that I did last Monday in there to make it easy for you to access. I'm glad to see that out of 144 people that have registered, 14 of you are on time. But at the same time, I know that it may be difficult to join. I know that in some countries, internet connectivity really is an issue. And that is why I'm recording this session as well. So that if you cannot make it on time in this live session, you can always attend my class through YouTube. Of course, that doesn't give you the benefit of asking questions, but you still can see what has been covered. I do see people appearing. I just want to have a quick confirmation that you can also hear me. So if you could please let me know in the chat that you can hear me, then I would appreciate. Just a simple test of the connectivity, because otherwise it would be a waste if I am talking and nobody is listening. Right, I can see a couple of confirmations coming in that you can hear me, that's good. I can also see your message, Mainza, that you have not received the link to the recording. I will publish the link to the recording again, but let me do that somewhere halfway today's session. Because I know from previous experience that some people have a problem connecting properly. So you will get the link to the recording later. Today, we have a two-hour program. So today, the program is shorter as the program that we did on Monday. And that is for the simple reason that I have another class today. And that class is about something that you should all think is interesting, the Living Open Source Foundation. We are the Living Open Source Foundation. And I know that some of you may not have an idea what exactly that is. So if you want to know more about the Living Open Source Foundation, here is the link where you can register. So I will be teaching this class until, for the next 1 hour, 45 minutes, more or less. In 1 hour, 45 minutes from now, I'm going to start the next class. This is not about Linux content, but it is a class about the Living Open Source Foundation, what we are doing, and how you can participate. And I think everybody who attends classes like this should know about the Living Open Source Foundation and what we can do in order to maybe help you even in your country. Excuse me. So right now I am going to start teaching about Linux, because that is what it is all about today. Right, again, I can see people who are not able to hear me. Naresh, I'm sorry for that, but there is not that much that I can do about it. And Levison, you mentioned, can he hear anything? Does it mean you can or you cannot hear me? I don't know, but I am going to get started anyway. Because if I'm going to try to troubleshoot everyone's single issue, we won't do much Linux today. So I am back on the Fedora virtual machine that we installed on Monday. On Monday, I explained what a virtual machine is, why it is useful to work with virtual machines. And now I want to pick up where we have been to on Monday. So in order to get access to my virtual machine, I've just pressed escape. You should see my virtual machine as well. I am sharing my application. I cannot verify that from your point of view, but you should be able to see my virtual machine. Please do let me know if that is not the case, if you're experiencing any problems. In the virtual machine, I'm going to log in with my user account. And then what do we see? Hilton Munich City hotspot login. That is kind of funny. Never experienced it. I need to log in my virtual machines as well. But you know what? I want to have internet connectivity from the virtual machine. And let me log in. As you may have guessed, today I am in Munich. In fact, I am in Munich for a living open source project. But for some reason, oh, can't find me. That is because I made a typo. In case you are wondering, what is he doing in Munich for a Living Open Source project? Well, as Living Open Source Foundation, we are organizing conferences, big meetings in different African countries. And that requires money because we need to fly there. We need to stay in hotels. We have our Living Open Source Foundation staff that we need to pay. So every now and then I go on an assignment and it's not me sending the invoice. It's Living Open Source Foundation. That is, by the way, also why tomorrow Pascal van Dam is filling in the third and last session for me. Right, for now, I am back on my Fedora virtual machine in my user account. And I am going to type the history command. The history command is showing a recent overview of commands that we have been using the last session. In the last session, we have talked about what is Linux, why do you want to use Linux. We have installed Fedora, we have talked about different Linux distributions, and I've talked about the file system. So what you can see is that I have roamed around in the file system, in the directory structure of the Linux operating system a little bit to demonstrate you what Linux is all about. Today, I want to continue about this file system. And I don't just want to talk about file system. I also want to talk about files. And I have a very good reason for that. And the reason is that managing files in Linux is a very important skill. Linux is often used as a server. You know, the platform that we are using right now, the streaming platform that we are using right now, there is Linux behind it. And on Linux servers, applications are running. And in order to use these applications in the best possible way, we need to configure the applications. And the configuration of applications is happening through files. So what I want to teach today, I want to teach a little bit more about directories. I want to tell you about the root user, because the root user is a user that brings you Linux superpowers. And then we are going to talk about working with files, as that is an essential skill in the Linux operating system. As you can see, I'm recording this session as well, and I will post the recording of this session in the different WhatsApp groups that exist in the different countries. If you don't know how to get access to the recording, well, you know at least how to find one of us. Just reach out to us, and we'll be happy to send you the link to the recording later. I will also put the link to the recording of last Monday in this group chat a little bit later today. But for now, I want to get started. So what did we do on Monday? We talked about a command like cd slash. And I told you that slash is the root directory. It's a starting point of the entire directory structure. And in this directory structure, we can find different directories. I've also told you that in these directories, it depends on who you are, what you can do. We have used a cd command to roam around a little bit. And I have used command like cd slash tmp, where slash tmp, the slash, is making it an absolute path. Absolute path means that we include all the information to get into this specific directory. So if I do cd tmp and from tmp I'm typing ls again, you can see that we see totally different data. And that is because this is the contents of the tmp directory, and before I was in the root directory. And all these directories have different data. For example, if I use /cd/usr, I still have different data. USR on Linux is like the program files directory on a Windows machine. And that's a completely different nature of directory than tmp and the user home directory and all these other directories. The command that I want to show you right now is touch. We talked about touch. Touch is a useful command that allows you to test if you can write. The touch command allows you to create an empty file. So if I type touch empty, it is going to try to see if it can create an empty file. And what do we see? We see that we get a permission denied. And that is because Linux is a multi-user operating system. In a multi-user operating system, it is typically not allowed for all users to create files in all locations, because that would bring you pollution of your file system. Pollution of your file system means that your files are going to end up in locations where you don't want them to be ending up. On Monday, we have talked about files a little bit. If you are an end user, your text documents can be files. The videos you have downloaded can be files. The music you have downloaded is stored as files. And in order to make it easier to find the appropriate files at the appropriate locations, we have directories. And that's the directory structure that we're talking about right now. Now we can see that as an ordinary user, if I use touch empty, I'm getting an error message. And I'm getting this error message because I don't have sufficient permissions. Now there are two solutions to fix that. Solution number one is to work as a more powerful user, and that would be the root user. Solution number two is to fix the permissions. I'm not going to explain fixing permissions today, because this is a Linux fundamentals course. And in a Linux fundamentals course, we shouldn't be talking about fixing permissions. We should talk about the basics. I do want to talk about this powerful user, which is the root user account. Right now, I'm user Sander van Vught at localhost. Sander van Vught, that's my name. If I want to open an environment where I am a root, I can use the command su minus. Do notice that it depends on the distribution where you are. Some Linux distributions, for security reasons, have disabled su minus. So you can try it, it might not work. I am going to try it and let's see if it does work. It's asking for a password. Su minus is asking for a password, and the password that I'm entering is my root password. And then it's going to wait a little bit, and oh no, I am getting an authentication failure. And you know what? I think that authentication as the root user on my system is not allowed. So I need to try something else. And the other approach is to use sudo minus I. That's another way to open a root shell. So I'm opening sudo minus I, and sudo minus I is asking for my password. And then I type my password, and then I'm in a root shell. Can we see that? Well, look carefully. In the lower left corner, you can see that right now I am a root at localhost. A root on Linux is a user with unlimited power. So it is very dangerous, in fact, to be using the root account, because if by accident you make a mistake while you are logged in as a root, there's a risk that you destroy everything on your system. So if you are going to work as a root, you really should know what you are doing. It happens to be that I know what I'm doing. So I am going back to the user directory, and I'm going to use again the command touch empty. And you know what? It works this time. Look at that. ls is showing me that the file with the name empty exists. And ls minus l is showing me that the file with the name empty exists, and at the same time that it is a 0-byte file, which means that the file is empty. Stopping in there. So why do I want to use the touch command? Well, for one single reason and one reason only. Before I am going to create big files or try to download big files to this directory, I want to make sure that I have write permissions. And the touch command is an ideal command to verify that I have write permissions. Now that I have verified, I can remove it as well. RM empty. And then it's gone again. Oh, because I am a root, there's some additional protection. If a root wants to remove a file, the root user needs to confirm. So it's asking, remove regular empty file empty? Yes, I want to remove it. And now after typing yes, it's gone. We can verify that because if I type ls again, I don't see my empty anymore. So we are back in the original environment. Right. You may wonder, when is it necessary to work as a root? Well, I have a simple answer to that. Normally, it's not necessary to work as root. You can just log in as an ordinary user, and your ordinary user account should allow you to do anything that you need to be doing. If you are going to switch your current role, and instead of being an ordinary user, you are going to be you are going to do administration tasks, then you need root privileges. I will talk about root privileges a little bit more later today, but before doing that, I want to talk about these files a little bit and how we can go on and manage files on a computer. Hey, there's something else that I want to discuss as well, and that is course materials. If you look at the interface, the course interface that we are using right now, somewhere in there should be a button that brings you to the course materials. And in the course materials, you will find a PDF file with the name Linux Fundamentals 1.0.pdf. In this PDF file, you will find the complete contents of my Linux Fundamentals course. That's a two-day course, and it covers a lot more than what we are doing in this class today. But it also covers everything that we are doing today and what we have done on Monday. So I would like to encourage you to download the Linux Fundamentals PDF. Use it as your reference guide. I don't like teaching slides. I like teaching by example. So I continue doing that, but I would like to invite you to download the PDF because I think it contains useful information. Right. We need to talk about these files a little bit. Because as I was just mentioning, if you are working on Linux, if you want to change something in the Linux environment, what it often comes down to is working with files. So I'm going to type exit first. By typing exit, I get out of my root shell. I get back to the ordinary shell, and I want to show the most important things to work with files. In order to create a file, we need an editor. You may be used to Windows. On Windows, there's Notepad as an editor. An editor is not the same as the document package in an Office suite. So Microsoft Word is not an editor. Editor on Linux is a program that allows you to create files without any layout. Now, why is that useful? Well, that is useful for the simple reason that these files without layout, the configuration files, are often used to change the behavior of services on Linux. So I want to introduce you to the editor VI. VI is an acronym and it stands for very important because it is a very important editor. But let me warn you. VI is not the easiest editor that exists. If you would be looking in, at a graphical interface, and in a graphical interface you are trying to create files, there are graphical editors. These are very simple to use. You start the graphical editor, you start editing, and that's all. If you would be looking at a command line interface, graphical editors are useless. So graphical editors is not what we are going to use. We are going to use VI. Now, VI is a command line editor. And you might wonder, wow, this editor is kind of difficult. Don't we have anything easier? And the answer is yes, we do have something easier. but we are not going to use it. There are a few very good reasons why everyone who takes Linux seriously should be interested in VI. Reason number one is that VI is always present. As we have discussed on Monday, there are different flavors of Linux, the distributions. And these distributions do everything according to their own taste. We have also discussed that Linux is family of the Unix operating system. That is an operating system that has been around since the early 1970s. There are many differences between Linux and Unix. There are many differences between the different Linux distributions. But there is one thing that is always the same. There is always VI. And that is one reason why you need to learn VI. Another reason why you need to learn VI, no matter how small your Linux distribution is, no matter how bad the troubleshooting mode is that you currently are in, there will always be VI to help you editing files. Editing files is a key skill, so you need to take the utility that helps you to edit files really very seriously. So that is what we are going to do. We are going to use VI. Now, there are two approaches to using VI. Approach number one, you type vim tutor. Vim tutor is starting a program, which is the vim tutor. It is starting it in VI and is giving you instructions. And now look at that. I get a command not found. That is so disappointing. But sometimes that happens. This is unexpected, but this is part of how it works in Linux. It's telling I want to run a command. It's telling me command not found. So my command is not currently installed. But fortunately, it is telling me that I have packages providing this file. And these packages are Vim X11 and Vim Enhanced. So I need to install Vim Tutor. How am I going to do that? I'm going to do that using sudo yum install Vim Enhanced. Now you might wonder what's happening here and why are you selecting Vim Enhanced? Well, the reason that I am selecting Vim Enhanced and not Vim X11 is because I know that Vim X11 is running in a graphical environment. I don't want any utilities that run in a graphical environment, but that because that creates a dependency to a graphical environment. And what we were discussing on Monday, Linux machines often run without a graphical environment. So that is why I'm using Vim Enhanced. And I'm also using Vim Enhanced because I know the package and I know that it's going to bring what I need. So I need to install this software package. In order to install software packages on Linux, there are these things called repositories. Repositories are online resources where software is available. So you don't have to go roaming any websites. You just type your yum install, and yum install will check in the repositories to see if it can find it. And if it can find it, it will start downloading it. We need to do that using sudo. And that is because the yum install command is installing software, and ordinary users cannot install software on Linux. So let me first do it without sudo. So just yum install vim enhanced. Here we are using the yum package manager, which by the way is a Red Hat / Fedora / CentOS specific package manager. I'm typing yum install vim enhanced, and you can see the message I'm getting is very specific. This command has to be run under the root user. And that is why I'm going to try it again. By the way, look at my cursor. I'm using Control A to move my cursor to the beginning of the command line, and I'm putting sudo in front. Sudo means that I want to run this command using root superpowers. So sudo yum install vim enhanced is first going to ask me for my password. What's happening? Well, not every user is allowed to use the sudo command to install software. There's an authorization behind it. And to verify that I'm an authorized user, it's asking for my password. And next, it's going to check and see if I have sudo superpowers. And if that is the case, it is going to install it, the package for me. Now, what do we see here? We see dependencies resolved. Now, what is that? I want to install Vim Enhanced. And in order to install Vim Enhanced, I need two additional software packages. Package number one is Vim Common. Package number two is gpm-libs. It's giving me an overview and it's telling me, okay, I need to download 8 megabytes. And once I'm done, we have installed 33 megabytes. Is that okay? Yes, that is okay. So I'm pressing Y for yes, that is okay. And then it is continuing. We need to give it just a little bit of time. And there we can see that Vim Enhanced has been installed. With the result that if I type Vim Tutor again, at this point, it works. Now have a look at what this is bringing you. This is bringing you the Vim Tutor. And you know, all you need to do is read. You can see right here that the approximate time required to complete the tutor is 25 to 30 minutes. So the Vim tutor is going to tell you, now do this, now do that. So it's going to invite you to experiment with Vim. And if you are going to do everything that is mentioned here, you will be done in about 30 minutes. So I would love to invite you, start Vim Tutor, use your arrow keys to scroll down and just try everything. And it will tell you how to proceed. And if you can only dedicate 3 minutes to it in lesson 1.2, it is telling you how to exit Vim. And then it continues. And by the time you are at the end of the document, you have learned everything you need to know about to work with Vim. I am not going to guide you through the Vim Tutor because Vim Tutor is an excellent way of learning Vim on yourself. So I'm using colon Q exclamation mark to get out of here. I want to get out of the Vim Tutor. I want to get back to my prompt and I want to teach you VI basics myself. Hey, VI basics. VI or Vim, you might wonder what exactly is it? Well, there's two things. There is VI, there is Vim. VI is the basic editor. That's the original version. It's a very minimal version. Vim is an enhancement to VI. And Vim is bringing some additional features that make working with VI a little bit easier. For what we are doing today, it comes down to the same. Doesn't matter if you are using VI or Vim, the functionality is going to be exactly the same because we are not going to do very many complicated things. So I hope you have your own Linux installation at hand at the moment. And if that is the case, then I would love to invite you to start your own Linux distribution, open a console and follow along. To start with, I am going to create a document, Vim, let's call it demo.txt. Notice that in Linux extensions like .txt, .doc, .mov or .mp3 or whatever, extensions in Linux are not really a requirement. But extensions are frequently used to make it easier for people to work with files. Because if you insert an extension, you can see what type of file it is. And that makes it a little bit easier. So I'm using Vim demo.txt. And what does that bring us? Well, that is opening a new file with the name demo.txt. And in this new file, I can start typing my text. Now, in order to type my text, what do I need to do? Well, I need to switch between command mode and input mode. In Vim, after starting it, by default, you are in command mode. And the nice thing about command mode is that this is a mode that allows you to type commands. In command mode, you cannot type text. You only can type commands. So if I want to type text, then the first challenge is how do I get into input mode? Well, let me write a little list for you. If I press I, you can see in the lower left corner, it changes and now it reads insert. And that means that by pressing I get into input or insert mode, which allows me to type text. So that allows me to create my document, and I'm going to document everything I'm telling you about VI in my document as well. Now, the thing is, once you are ready typing your text, you need to issue a command to save your text. And in order to do that, you need to get back to command mode. And in order to get back to command mode, you press escape. Back to command mode. So these are the very first manipulations that really you should know about in order to work with VI. I for input mode, escape for back to command mode. Let me give you some more commands that you can use once you are in command mode. One very important command is colon WQ exclamation mark, which is write, quit, and don't complain. Write and quit, that's easy to understand, I guess. That will just save your file and quit VI. The don't complain part means that if VI has any questions, it's trying to avoid asking any questions. It will just write and quit, and that is everything. Instead of doing colon WQ, you can also use colon W, colon Q exclamation mark. And I don't think I have to write down what this is all about. Colon W is right. Colon Q exclamation mark is quitting. Colon Q exclamation mark is a nice way of getting out of a document if you are not sure what happened. Sometimes it can happen that you are in a document, you touch some key and magical stuff is happening. And you think, oh no, did I mess up my document? Well, if you are afraid that you mess up your document, the only thing to do is press escape and press colon Q exclamation mark. There's another thing that is useful, and that is the U command. U is for undo. Undo is just reverting the last operation that you have used. I am not going to try to overwhelm you with VI commands, so I'm trying to keep it quite minimal at this time. So let me just add some more very important commands like DD. DD is for delete current line. Very often in VI, you work on lines. If you work on configuration files have different lines to enable or disable specific functionality in the file. So operations that you are using with VI are very often line-oriented. And DD is for deleting the current line. And I think with just these commands, you should be able to get around pretty well in VI. Right, everybody who does hear me, I do see that some people have connectivity issues. So it's only two of them. Give me 1 minute to see if I can help them through a group chat. It's Grace and Lucio. I am aware on an internet-based platform like this, bandwidth is an issue, but apart from the bandwidth, it's also the application that is an issue. If anybody who is currently listening to me has experienced connectivity problems for themselves, if you think you can help people that are complaining that they don't hear anything, please feel free to post your messages in the chat as well. The chat is yours, so do with it whatever you want. Right. I am going to include a few more commands in VI. They're useful. Oops, back to this document. I like GG. GG is to change your current position in a document. Go to top of document. You know, sometimes in VI you are working with very large documents. And if you are working with large documents, then it is useful if you can easily move your current position to somewhere else. And there's uppercase G, which is go to end of document. And the last, no, two more things that I want to show you. Slash some text is going to search for some text in the document. And N will repeat last search. The very last thing that I want to tell you about VI, and then I'm really going to stop, is the global substitute. It's a little bit longer. If you use percent colon percent S for substitute, alt text slash new text slash G, then you are going to replace all occurrence of alt text with new text. And that is useful as well. All right, at this point I am happy with my VI document. So what am I going to do? Well, I think I am going to quit my document and save. So what is the first thing to do in order to write and quit? Well, the first thing to do, I need to get back from input mode to command mode. And in order to get from input mode to command mode, I am pressing escape. Look at the lower left corner. You don't see the word insert anymore. And that means that right now we are in command mode. And as we are back in command mode at this point, I can use the appropriate command to write and quit, which is, well, colon W Q exclamation mark. Again, look at the lower left corner of my interface. In the lower left corner, you can see exactly what I am doing using this this command. So if you have any errors in the command, you can use the backspace key to correct. And if you are happy with it, well, there we go. We have written and we have quitted this demo.txt configuration file. So that is about VI. Again, VI is your text editor, and VI is the only thing that you should use on Linux servers or embedded Linux to work with your configuration files. All right, Grace, can you hear me now? Because I see Grace logged in twice. And Grace was one of the people that had problems with connectivity. I can see one with, you can hear me. Great. Happy to hear that. I think that Lucio is the only one who cannot hear us, but seems to be offline. So one of the unfortunate things with Health of Planet between us, there is not so much that I can do to help you. Right. I want to talk about some more commands that allow you to work with text file. Macmillan Licato, I'm not going to repeat the last part of VI, if you don't mind. I'm making a recording of this session. So if you want me to repeat it, wait until the recording is available. You can watch the recording. You can see it from there. I'm going to process the recording directly after this session. Hopefully it's fast enough so that I can still upload it tonight, and then it should be available somewhere tomorrow. We just have a little bit of time, and I'm trying to use our time as efficiently as possible. Right. I would like to talk about commands that are about text files a little bit more. And this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to talk a few more minutes about commands that are about text files. Then we do a break. and then we do the second part of today. Today I am teaching two chunks of 45 minutes each approximately. In case you have missed it, in 1 hour 20 minutes I am hosting a meetup. This meetup is about Living Open Source Foundation, and that is going to explain what Living Open Source Foundation is doing to everybody interested. We will have people from all around the world who are coming to join the meetup. If you are interested in the meetup and if you have not yet been registered, here is the link. You can find it in group chat. You can register for it, and you are going to use the exact same platform that we are using right now. Okay, before the break, a couple more commands that are useful when working with text files. As I was mentioning, yes, nowadays, colon WQ is for save and quit. Save, quit, and don't complain. Let me show you the contents of the demo.txt file again. This time, I'm using cat. VI is an editor, so you would use VI if you want to edit files, if you want to make any changes to the contents of a file. This time, I don't want to make changes. I just want to show the contents of a file. And in order to do that, I'm using cat. Cat is a very useful command. It just dumps the contents of file on screen. So if you want to see again what I just typed in my document, here we go. Here is the contents of the document. The reason I'm using cat, well, cat is very convenient because you don't have to do any colon Q or whatever to get out of there. It's just dumping the contents of the file on screen. Now, there is a weird command that is related to that. Look at it. It's tac, T-A-C, demo.txt. Let me press enter. And then if you see the difference, you are more than welcome to tell me in chat. Do you see it? I just use tac instead of cat. And, well, if you see it, just let me know. It's the same contents, but it's the contents in a reversed order. Tech is cat in reversed order, as you can see in the name. And when you use tech, you see the last line of the file on the top, and you see the first line of the file on the bottom. Some people consider that a useful utility. To be honest, I don't think it's the most useful utility that exists, but it's kind of cool, and maybe you are going to use it one day sooner or later. Now, the cat utility allows you to see contents of files. For small files, that works. For big files, it doesn't. I'm going to open a root shell again. Again, after the break, I will tell you everything you need to know about this sudo thing and about opening a root shell. But right now, I'm just going to open it. So I'm going to type my password, and then I'm back in my root shell. And in my root shell, I am going to show you cat on var log messages. Var log messages, what? We are on Fedora, and Fedora doesn't seem to have a var log messages file anymore. Let me check. ls minus l. In the old days, Linux was logging information to var log messages. In the new days, it's not logging information to var log messages anymore. I know what's happening, but let's not focus on that. Let's have a look at last log. Last log, if we look at the file size here, seems to be a big file. Or another a relatively big file is boot.log. Boot.log contains boot messages. If I have a big file and I do a cat on that, then look what's happening. The entire contents of the file scrolls by. But I need to use my mouse to get back to the beginning of the file. And the thing is in Linux that Linux is a console-oriented operating system. So you don't always have a mouse at hand. So using cat for big files is not the best utility that you can imagine. If you want to use a big file, I would recommend use less. Less is what we call a pager. And that means that the LESS utility is going to open the file within the utility. And, maybe a binary file, see it anyway. Yeah, I want to see it anyway. There's some code that LESS doesn't really understand, which are just escapes. I don't care about that. What I do care about is that LESS is showing it page by page. And that means that you can move forward by pressing the space bar. And you can move backwards by pressing the page up key. And that is what you really want to use if you need to investigate what is in a file. Also useful to know, LESS is based on VI. So some things that work in VI also work in LESS. Like uppercase G to go all the way to the bottom of the file, like lowercase G to go all the way to the top of the file, or like slash followed by whatever to search for text. So I'm searching for the text hostname, and look at that, it goes to the first occurrence of the text hostname. And that is what LESS is doing. Now, you may have heard of a related utility, which is the MORE utility. And what I'm going to say now may not make sense at all. On Linux, LESS is doing more than MORE. MORE is a very old utility. It has been around forever. The big disadvantage of the MORE utility is that you cannot scroll up in the MORE utility. You can only go down in the MORE utility. And that is not so very convenient, because very often you'll be reading a file, and after reading something in the beginning of the file, later in the file you find something which urges you to go back to the beginning of the file. And with the MORE utility, you can't. And that is why, as folks say, LESS is doing more than MORE. So use LESS, not MORE. Right. It's time for a short break. And in order to do our short break, I am going to run our countdown script again. I think 15 minutes is too long, but I do want to have a short break anyway. So I feel like making it 12 minutes. So I'm running /countdown followed by 12. And after the break, we will talk about sudo. We will also talk a little bit more about this countdown script. And then we will continue talking a little bit more about file-based utilities. But first, 12-minute break. I'm going to mute myself during the break, but I will be back after 12 minutes. All right, our break is about over. Let me get organized. For the people that have just joined us, I do notice that the attendee list today is quite dynamic, and that quite a few people have joined us who were not here in the beginning of the course. Today is a 2-hour session, which means that we have one more block to go, and then this shorter session is over. For the reason that after this session, I'm hosting an online class. Well, it's not really a class, it's more like a meetup about Living Open Source Foundation. So if you want to know what Living Open Source Foundation is all about, you are more than welcome to join that class. The link is in the group chat right now. Also, tomorrow I won't be hosting this session myself. I have myself replaced with Pascal Van Dam. Pascal Van Dam is not only an excellent instructor, he's also a friend of mine, and he will be hosting tomorrow's session. I will make sure he is briefed, and you will notice that Pascal is a very good instructor, and I'm sure that you are going to like him as well. And if you want to see me again, well, if you are from Malawi, make sure you attend our event in May. We'll be coming to Malawi out of top of my head, May 11th until 15th. We will be in Blantyre again to do an LFCS prep session. If you are from Rwanda, I'm looking forward to meeting Daniel and many other Rwandese myself in May, week 4 May. No, that should be 6 until 8 of May. And if you are from any other country in Africa that we haven't covered yet, be in touch. And we can always see what we can do in your country. Right. That's all I wanted to mention about generic stuff. At this point, I am going to show you my drawing application, because I want to talk about the root user and about sudo and su and stuff like that, which is quite significant stuff. And in order to make sure that you get it, what it's all about, I'd like to make a drawing. I'm preparing my drawing application, and you cannot see it yet. I am working on that right now. And whoop, now you should see my drawing application. As it takes a few seconds to synchronize to all the corners of the world, let me give it a few seconds before I make my drawing. So what is this root user all about? Well, in the architecture of the Linux operating system, there's a fundamental difference between what we call kernel space and user space. I think I taught this on Monday as well, but the problem is I did 2 Linux fundamental courses this week, so I'm not sure anymore what I did when. So just to make sure, brief overview. In kernel space, we have the Linux kernel, and the main task of the Linux kernel is to address hardware. And Linux is doing that by using drivers. And there's user space, and in user space, that is where your processes are running, and that is where your users are available. Now, users and processes can go to kernel space, but in order to do that, there are some filtering mechanisms. Filter number one is the system calls. Filter number two is the permissions. And at this layer of filtering, an administrator can decide who is going to get access to which specific system call, who is going to get access to which specific permission. So the key word in user space is limited. What processes can do is limited, what users can do is limited, and the limitation comes from the system calls as well as the permissions. Now, how does that relate to our root user? Well, it is very simple. the root user is living here. And that means that the root user really is an unrestricted user, because the root user is living below the world where system calls and permissions are applied. Some people call the root user the almighty. You might not like that too much, but I would like to mention it anyway, because there's a sense in that that I do understand. There are no limitations for the root user. Compare it to the Windows administrator. If you want to draw the Windows administrator user in this picture, then I would say the Windows administrator user is a user that is sitting here and who is getting access to all system calls and all permissions. But the fact that the Windows administrator has access to all system calls and all permissions also means that you can take it away from them. The root user, being a kernel space user, cannot be limited. And that is what makes using this root user account pretty dangerous, and that is why you should not use the root user account by default. You should be very, very careful with that. Now, how do we use the root user account? Well, let me also make a drawing about that. New drawing. So what are we going to do in this new drawing? Well, in this new drawing, I want to talk about two options for an ordinary user to get root superpowers. Option number one is to use the command su minus. You can also use su without a minus, just don't. The command is su minus. And if you use su without a minus, you are missing functionality. At this point in your learning curve, in getting familiar with Linux, you don't want to know what exactly the difference is. Just believe me. Su minus, that is the command and nothing else. What do we do if we use su minus? Well, we open what we call a root shell. A root shell is an environment where you are the root user. In order to do that, you need to enter the root password. Notice that many distributions don't have a root password set. So on many distributions, this is not going to work. And that is because su minus is not the most elegant and most secure solution. A much more secure solution is to use sudo. More specifically, sudo minus I also opens a root shell. Sudo some command, that's becoming unreadable. Let me make sure that it's staying readable. So sudo some command, like sudo user add, allows you to run one specific command with root superpowers. Behind sudo configuration, there is a couple of things. The first thing that is behind it is that you need an authorization. So authorization is required. If you don't have the authorization, if you don't have the permissions, you cannot use sudo. So there needs to be a configuration behind sudo, otherwise it's just not going to work. This authorization is created by using a command with the name vi sudo or by making a user a member of the group, of a group, so group membership. And this group membership on Red Hat and related, the name of that group is wheel. On Ubuntu and related, the name of that group is ADM. The nice thing about sudo is that you have an option to work with some granularity. Now, what does that mean? Well, granularity means that you don't have to give permissions to all commands. You can give permissions to a limited number of commands. And that is nice. So you can use different function roles if you want to. You can create a sudo configuration for help desk people or for people that need to maintain an Oracle database to make sure that they just get access to that and nothing else. Another thing that is very nice about sudo is that it's not asking for the root password, it is asking for the user password. And that makes that su minus works, but it's dangerous. So let's mark it with red. And sudo user add also works, and that is the better solution of making sure that you you get the appropriate permissions, that you can work in a root shell. I hope that makes sense, because with that in mind, I am going to demonstrate how it all works. Kevin is asking about man pages. Kevin, obviously you have not attended our session last Monday, because last Monday we talked about man pages. If somebody can brief Kevin, that would be helpful, I guess. I can also give you a quick demo in my upcoming demo, which is going to be right now. I'm going to switch to the appropriate screen, which is popping up right now. First thing that I want to do, I want to demonstrate sudo in su minus. The essence of everything, I am user Sander van Vught, and as we have seen, I can use sudo minus I. So apparently I have authorization to use sudo. Why do I have authorization to use sudo? Well, that is because I'm a member of the group Wheel. I'm using ID on Sander van Vught. Notice that I'm a root at this point, but as a root, I can use commands on any users. So I'm using ID on Sander van Vught. And what do we see? We see that Sander van Vught is a member of two groups. One group is Sander van Vught, the other group is Wheel. If a user is a member of the group Wheel, the user can run tasks using sudo. Right, at this point, I'm going to create a new user. I'm still in my root shell, but let's not do it from the root shell. Let's do it the nice way. So I'm using sudo user add Edwin. I want to create a user with the name Edwin. As I recently have entered my password to get access to sudo superpowers, I don't have to add my password anymore, and I've just created a user with the name Edwin, who is now present. And I'm going to use sudo pass wd Edwin to make sure that Edwin has a password as well. Also, this is something that I need to do with the sudo command in front, because really, you don't think that ordinary users have permissions to change everybody's password. Fortunately not. So here we can see that user Edwin has been created. Now I'm going to use su minus Edwin. Now what is that? Look carefully. Currently, I'm in a shell as user Sander van Vught. So my current username is Sander van Vught. And I want to switch identity on Linux. Now, why would you ever want to do that? Well, in a system administrator role, it is quite useful if you are capable of switching identity. You take the identity of another user to figure out if functionality is available for the other user, or to test something as the other user. If you are a developer, then you are probably never going to use this command to switch identity to another user. But if you are in system administration, this is very, very useful. So I'm typing su minus Edwin. What is it asking? It's asking for a password. That would be the password of user Edwin. And now I'm typing password, and I'm currently logged in as Edwin. Or better, I'm in a shell as user Edwin. So in my big environment, I'm still Sander. Look at this. If I click on terminal and I open a new window, in my new window, as you can see right here, I'm still Sander van Vught. But this new window is not what it is about. In my current session, in this window, at this point, I'm user Edwin, and I can type commands and verify what user Edwin can do. PWD is showing that I'm in slash home Edwin, and that means that really I am Edwin at this moment. Wow, Edwin must be thinking, keep on dreaming, dude, that ain't gonna happen, but just the demo. Right. Now, as Edwin, I'm going to use sudo user add Bob. What do you think? Is that going to work? Well, the sudo mechanism is first asking for the password of user Edwin. So I am entering the password for user Edwin. And then, we get an error message. Edwin is not in the sudoers file. This incident will be reported. So what is happening here? Well, in order to run tasks using sudo, you need authorization. And how did we do that again? Well, the easiest way to provide sudo superpowers to users is by making them a member of the group wheel. So I'm going to verify as my current user account, I'm typing ID, and you can see there's a lot of information. This is about SE Linux, please ignore. This is the part that it's all about. I see groups 1002 Edwin. So user Edwin is a member of group Edwin. And that is something that I want to change. So I'm going to exit my current Edwin environment so that I'm Sander van Vught again. And I'm going to use sudo user mod minus ag wheel Edwin. What is this doing? This is using sudo privileges to call the user mod command. And the user mod command using dash lowercase a, uppercase g. Don't forget that Linux is case sensitive. So lowercase and uppercase is really important here. Using dash ag wheel, I'm going to add the user to the group wheel. And at this point, Edwin should be a member of the group wheel. Let's verify that. Sudo id Edwin. And what do we see? We see Edwin is in the group wheel. So let's test it. Su minus Edwin. I'm opening the shell as user Edwin is again. Which really is the same as logging in as user Edwin, but just in this session. And now user Edwin is using sudo user add Bob, and it's asking for password. And look at that. Linux didn't complain. Now in Linux, it's very easy to understand. If Linux doesn't complain, then it's happy. So it didn't complain, so it created user Bob. You can see that, by the way, if I would use tail on etc pass wd. Etc pass wd is a file that stores user accounts and user passwords. And what do we see? We see Sander van Vught and Edwin Zimba and Edwin and Bob. And that is how you can work with su and sudo. Zenet has a question. So if you add a user Edwin in our case and give them all the admin privilege, can they access using your name given they have your password? It's worse. So Zenet is curious about security implications of this. We have given Edwin the option to run any command as root. So Edwin can use sudo su minus Sander. The sudo part makes that Edwin is running it as root. And because Edwin is, sorry, it's not the right name. Because Edwin is running this command as root, and because Edwin has recently entered his own command, his own password to authorize sudo commands, he isn't even prompted for a password. And right now, Edwin is in my shell, and he can do whatever he wants to do. So don't think that if you are using sudo that you are in a secure environment. No, sudo is potentially a very dangerous command because it can easily be abused if you give it to an unresponsible person. What, for example, do you think if Edwin is going to use sudo pass wd root? I mean, if you are if you have sudo powers, you can use passwd on a specific user. And using sudo passwd root, Edwin is changing password for user root, going once, going twice. There we go. Edwin has just taken over the root user account. And if Edwin is an evil hacker, then the system is his. And next time good old root is going to try to log in, good old root doesn't have the password anymore. So good luck, root user. Your system is owned at the moment. Bottom line of this, if you want to give root superpowers to a user, first thing that is important is, can you trust the user? Because with great power comes great responsibility. And if you have a user that you don't trust, then you need to be more specific in what you want to do. And you know what? Let me show you that as well, now that we are talking about it. It might be going a little bit deep, but it's an interesting topic, so let me make it complete. I'm going out of the admin shell, because I want to limit admin's possibilities again. Just the imaginary situation and any resemblance with real existing persons is a pure coincidence. Of course, you understand that, Mr. Zimba, don't we? But let's normalize the situation and let me show you how you can do it in a more secure way. So I'm going to use sudo user mod -g what? No, sudo what? I want to take away the user membership, user mod -- help. To be honest, I don't exactly remember how to remove group membership from a user using user mod. But fortunately, there is user mod -- help. And there we can see dash G is a new list of supplemental groups. I'm looking for something to replace the append. You see that append adds a group, but I don't see a minus R to remove a group. So maybe sudo user mod minus G nothing to admin will help. I'm afraid it's not going to help. Okay, I need to hack it. And in order to hack it, I am going to use sudo vim on etc group. After all, user membership is administered in the file etc group. In etc group, I can see the group wheel, and in the group wheel, I see Sander van Vught and Edwin. And now Edwin is gone. So Edwin is not the sudo user anymore. And now I'm going to use sudo vi sudo to create a nicer solution. Notice that we are in vi sudo. You have any idea why the name of the command is vi sudo? You got it, because we are using a vi interface. I'm using uppercase G to go all the way down. And if I go all the way down, and I see this example file, and I'm going to base it on this example file, and I'm going to create a nice solution for user Edwin. But first, let's try to understand the highlighted line. The highlighted line is mentioning percent users. Percent users refers to users who are a member of the group users. They can use all is sbin mount mnt cd-rom, sbin umount mnt cd-rom. The all is kind of mandatory, means no matter where the user is coming from. The sbin mount and the sbin umount, these are commands that the user can be running. Now, what do I want to do? I want to create user Edwin, and I am going to mention all is slash user sbin user add. Edwin can use user add. And slash user bin pass WD. Is this more secure? Well, I think it is, because in this case, user Edwin is no longer capable of running all commands. User Edwin can create users and set user passwords. While I'm demonstrating, please start thinking if there is anything in this example line that is not secure. But let me demonstrate. So I'm opening a shell as user Edwin again. And as user Edwin, I'm using sudo user add bill. So Edwin needs to enter his password. And as you can see, that is allowed. Sudo user del bill. There we get user admin is not allowed. For the simple reason, we have allowed user add, we have not allowed user del. Sudo pass WD bill. Is that going to be allowed? Yes, of course. Asking changing password. all authentication tokens updated successfully. But hey, what is happening if Edwin is trying this? You may think about it while I'm using what Bill, what a coincidence, I just created user Bill, what Bill is mentioning. So Bill is mentioning if user Edwin has been assigned admin privileges, any person logging using that user ID will be able to do all admin power changes. So please keep one user per person for security reasons. Yes, absolutely. That's a good point that you are mentioning here, Bill. In some companies, multiple users are using the same Linux user account. So multiple people are using the same Linux user account. That is definitely a very bad idea. And thinking about what we see here, I granted sudo superpowers to user Edwin, but in a limited way. Edwin can use user add and pass WD. Does that make my configuration more secure? Well, it depends. If Edwin still can do this, it really doesn't. Now, does it? And that is because if you grant user Edwin the right to use the pass WD command, then he can use pass WD on anybody, even on me. So Edwin can still lock out everybody. Do we want that? No, I don't want that. So I get back to my Sander van Vught shell, and I'm using sudo pi sudo again. And all the way down, I am going to add one more thing, and I hope I have the syntax remembered all right. That is user bin pass WD root. So what do we see here? We see exclamation mark, user bin pass WD root. Exclamation mark is how you can exclude something. So here we specify that user Edwin can run user bin pass WD, but he cannot run user bin pass WD root. And if that works, you might want to do it on other user accounts as well. So one more time, su minus Edwin. And let me use sudo pass WD root. And there we go. User Edwin is not allowed to execute user bin pass WD root. Let me also use your sudo pass WD on Sander van Vught. And there you can see Sander van Vught is not protected. So if I want to protect user Sander van Vught as well, I need to create another exception. All right. That was a lot of information before I continue and talk the last 15 minutes of today's session about another topic. I want to make sure that you don't have any question. So you know what? You get a question asking minute. I put my timer on 1 minute. What? 1 minute? Oh, I need set custom time. If you have any question, please ask. If not, then in 1 minute, we will continue. I see no questions coming in. Well, we just take it as a nice, another 30-second break in that case. Naresh, user not allowed to execute. Yeah, user not allowed to execute because we just created an exception for user Edwin in which we specified in the vi sudo that user bin pass WD root is not allowed. What should I change on VI? Naresh, you may have been multitasking while I was explaining. So please watch the recording. You can find it in the recording. I'm always willing to help with some additional explanation, but if it's so obvious that you weren't present when I just explained, then yeah, I'm going to move on to something else. Anyway, I hope you understand. I'd rather do something new in the last couple of minutes. Right. What is the something new? Well, I think we should go back to the files. We have talked about files a lot, and I want we have talked about creating files using VI. I also want to show you how you can copy files and move files and do other common file management tasks. Let me just verify, did I already do something like that? Or this is user Edwin. Edwin history, we don't see that much. How about my history? We did cd and ls and sudo, we did not do cp. Good. Webnong has a question. Can we also add some of this user configuration to automatically be assigned to new users, like what happens with files in etc skeleton? To automatically assign it to a new user, well, Webnong, if you want new users to be part of some sudo configuration, then the solution would be to create a line in sudo for your new user and just make sure that your new user, let's do that again. If you want to automatically assign sudo privileges to new users, then the best approach is to assign these privileges to a group and make users who need these privileges member of the group. And if a user doesn't need these privileges, then just don't make them a member of the group. Etc skeleton is really for environment files for the new users. Right. I'm going to talk about copy a little bit. So let's do ls etc hosts. That's the etc host file. That is just a random file for your information. It contains information about IP addresses and host names that belong to the IP address. If I use cp etc hosts to slash tmp, do you think that is allowed? Well, all of it depends on my access permissions, but since everybody can write files to the tmp directory, yes, this is allowed. If I use cp etc hosts to usr, is that allowed? No, that is not allowed. I'm getting permission denied. And that is good, because there's not one good reason why the etc host file should be copied to the USR directory. CP is copy and it allows you to copy individual files. Why do you want to do that? Well, for the availability of the files in question. You can use CP in many different ways. For example, you can use CP minus R recursive slash etc to dot. What is dot? Dot is the current directory. What is cp minus r etc to dot? It's trying to copy the etc directory to dot, which is the current directory. Do notice that we get a couple of permission denied. These permission denied are all about configuration files that I don't have access to with my simple current user account. But in etc, there's a lot of configuration files that I do have access to. And these configuration files are now copied to a subdirectory in my home directory. One nice command to see what is in a subdirectory. I don't know if the utility is installed. Yes, it is installed. It's tree. Tree is showing the tree structure of a directory. It's too much. It doesn't fit on one screen. But it's an excellent solution to show all subdirectories and all files in these subdirectories. And you can see that's no less than 414 directories and 1,738 files. And if on second thought I decide I don't want to have this directory anyway, then I can use rm. What do you think? Is rm etc going to work? Unfortunately not. It's complaining etc is a directory. If you want to remove a directory, you need rm minus f. Sorry, not minus f, minus r. Rm minus r etc. And then it's going to ask, do you want to remove this file? Yes, do you want to remove this file? And if you continue like this, you need to type 1738 times yes again. Let's not do that. Let's use Control C. Control C key sequence is a key sequence that you want to use to tell Linux, hey Linux, better stop what we are doing. I need to try it again. I want to use rm minus rf, where the minus r is for the directory and the f is for force. Force meaning I don't want to press yes to confirm on every single file that I want to remove it. Rm minus rf etc is just removing the directory. Did you see this? It's gone. There is no recycle bin on Linux. So if you accidentally from the command line remove an entire directory, there is no easy way back. There is a recycle bin in graphical user interfaces, but nobody is using graphical user interfaces. It brings us back to the basic principle of Linux. Linux is for people that know what they are doing. Oh, and what do you think, by the way, of rm-rf/? Do you think that's a good idea? Let me think about it. Isn't Sander van Vught this dude who has sudo superpowers? Yes, that is right. But Sander van Vught is not using sudo. Oh, and you also see that rm is complaining. It's dangerous to operate recursively on slash. I know. Use --- no preserve root. And what do we get if we do that? We get a lot of error messages for the simple reason that Sander van Vught is trying to remove files where he has no business removing them. I need to scroll up because if the command was fast enough, it may be that I accidentally wiped the contents of my home directory. As you can see, it has been quite fast. Do I still have files? Yeah, I still have files. And that's probably because /proc for some reason is considered before /home is considered. Right. There's one more thing that I want to tell you about files. It's something that looks a lot like a copy, but it's not. It's a link. And in order to explain links, I'm going to show you my use case for links. Hang on, I need to prepare this. There we go. And I am going to show you the interface on my Mac. There we go. What am I doing on my MacBook? Well, macOS is an operating system that is based on Unix. It's very closely related to the Linux operating system. In my MacBook, I'm running the same bash shell as what is running in Linux. And many commands that work in Linux are available in the MacBook as well. Right here, we are in my working directory. It's a very important directory, books and vids. That is my working directory for all the books that I've written and all the video courses that I have recorded. With my video courses, I create GitHub repositories. So I am in the GitHub directory. Excuse me. As you can see, there's quite a couple of GitHub repositories. Some GitHub repositories are very closely related to one another, like for example Kubernetes, CKAD, CKA, and Kube4H. They're all about Kubernetes, and sometimes I need to do the same thing in multiple locations. Like for example, if I do find dot minus name kube setup dot sh. Now you can find that I have a kube setup script in quite a few locations. Now my kube setup script, bash shell scripts, a bash shell script that allows me to set up machines in an easy way. So I tell my students, hey, make sure you install a recent Fedora virtual machine and run my kube setup script. But the thing is, Kubernetes has a new release every 3 months. And that means that I regularly update my kube setup script. But hey, then I have a management problem. And the management problem is that I have not one, but 7 different locations of this kube setup script. Does that really mean that I need to update 7 different kube setup scripts? No, it doesn't. I need to use hardlinks. Now, let me explain what hardlinks are about. We're back in the drawing application. And in the drawing application, I can explain about the inode. Now, what is the inode? The inode is the administration of your file. Everything you do in a file is stored in the inode. And the inode is referring to the blocks. The blocks are the physical location on disk where your file is stored. From a user perspective, if you want to access a file, you have a name /dir/myfile. This name points to the inode, and the inode brings me to the block. You could say that the inode really is the file. And once you're in the inode, you have access to the file. Now, the nice thing about the Linux operating system is that you can assign a name to the inode. Most operating systems allow you to assign one name. In Linux, you can have multiple names to the same inode, like name2, like name3, or like in the case of my MacBook, CKAD/cube setup. Oh, I can't write anymore. And cube4hours/cube setup. And the trick that I'm using here, I'm using hard links. And what does that mean? That means that if I change either one of my cube setup scripts, the change is reflected everywhere. And the nice thing about a hard link is that there is no difference between the original and the hard link that you have created later. So that makes it very easy to make sure that all contents on all of these files is synchronized. You can never do that if you create a copy of a file. So you could say that a hard link, it's not even a synchronized copy. It is just a different way of referring to the same file. Abigail is asking, what can I really relate inode with in Windows? You cannot. Windows is using a completely different file system. And this is something that is very typical and essential for Linux operating system. Right. I'm going to demonstrate hard links and how it works. In order to do that, I am opening a root shell because I think I'm going to need root superpowers. I'm going to use ln etc hosts to my hosts. Now I use ls -l /etc/hosts, my hosts. And what do we see? We see two files that have the same size and the same date and so on. I'm using the option ls -il. The minus I is showing the inode number. And the inode number, that is the unique administration of the file. And the fact that these have the same inode number means that it is the same file. And that proves if I use echo hello greater than create greater than, I'm using command line redirection to append to the file. So I'm adding the text hello to the file my hosts. I'm using ls -il, and what do we see? We see that etc hosts as well has changed. And if I use get on etc hosts, then you can see hello has been added. Because really, this is the same file using two different names. That's a hard link, and hard links are awesome. Hard links do have some limitations, and the limitation is that you cannot create a hard link to a file that is somewhere else on a different server or on a different device. And also you cannot create hard links to directories. And that is why there is also this thing called symbolic link. To create a symbolic link, I'm using ln -s, etc hosts, sim hosts. And let me use ls -il again on etc host, my host, and also on sim hosts. And what do we see? We see that sim host is a different file. New inode, new permissions, different size, different date setting. And sim host is pointing to etc hosts. So if I get to simhost, I still get access to the contents of etc host. But if I remove etc hosts, yes, I want to remove it, then we can see using ls -il that the myhost file still exists, The simhost file is marked in an ugly red color for the simple reason that the simhost file is pointing to something that does not exist anymore. It's a broken link, as we call it. Fortunately, as I still have the other hard link, this is relatively easy to fix. I'm using ln my hosts to etc hosts, and now everything is fixed again. And with that, we are out of time for today. Once more, I will be teaching my other class, my Living Open Source meetup, starting in 15 minutes. That's why I'm leaving you now, so that I can start the other session and make sure that we can start it on time. Again, I want to thank you very much for attending today's session. Tomorrow, Pascal Van Dam will be hosting part 3 of this session. I will make sure that he knows what we've been doing, and I hope you are going to enjoy his teaching. So once more, thank you very much, everybody. And I hope to see many of you in my meetup starting in 15 minutes. I'm out of here. Bye-bye.